Welcome back. The market's holding on to most of its gains, and autos have had a pretty good ride today. The other interesting stock is actually ITC, steadily moving higher, 2% up, and we're 200 plus, of course, on ITC. Prakash, let me ask you about this one. I mean, you know, these days in the market, you're trying to look for stocks that aren't at their historic high valuations and even above that. ITC is one such stock, but would it make the cut for you?
Oh, it does. It does, undoubtedly, Surbhi. You know, so yes, you're right. Every time you screen stocks, trying to seek stocks which meet certain size and scale parameters and growth parameters, and have still not kind of scaled their 52-week highs, it definitely stands out. And the reason is, there is this divided, you know, the street is completely divided on whether ITC is worth having on your portfolio or not. It could be a great business, but whether it's a great portfolio pick. And that's the opportunity why it's available at probably, I think, reasonable valuations from that perspective. I would be surprised all the headwinds related to agri exports, the kind of leadership they have clocked in some of the segments they've recently got into. And when I say recent, by their historic standards, they were only into tobacco. All newer businesses remained new for a fairly long time. It's now that they've matured and they've become number two in some of the categories like Yippee on noodles, Bingo on the this thing after Lay's. Of course, Ashirwad is a leader. And you know, the big indicator of a turnaround in the mindset of the management has been the acquisition of Savlon and Johnson & Johnson. And this was where they took it at about 65 crores top line. It's crossed 1,000 crores already. So I think they're getting their act together. They've realigned distribution in a big way. And that's what you'd like in an underlying business of how the model is kind of evolving and keeping pace with the product demand. So I'm a believer that they will get their act right. And then probably you'll see some unlocking of value at some stage. But it will probably test your patience for some more time, given that people are willing to sell it at every rise. But it's an opportunity in this market, which is probably seeming a bit crowded on the top.
Prakash, we will leave it there today. Thanks a lot for joining us on the first day of the new year. And of course, we wish you a very happy 2021. Sunil Singhania is joining us now, founder of Abacus Asset Management. Sunil, good afternoon. Thanks a lot for joining us. And, you know, as we, you know, usher in the new decade, first of all, season's greetings and happy new year to you, your family and your team. Tell us, what's the best investment thesis right now as we step into 2021?
Thanks for having me. I know it's always a pleasure to be on your channel. And wishes to you, everyone at CNBC TV 18 and all the viewers. So, you know, we head into 2021 and you have been, you know, sort of cribbing last few days. We are the only market which is open. But I think looking at the market opening today, it's not a bad day. I think we have started on a good positive note. I think from our side, you know, the one, I would say the biggest, whatever, you know, view we would give is it's still time to be long equity, and we still believe that equity even in 2021 would make decent returns. So, you know, I would start with that.
Okay, so Sunil, greetings of the day of the season to you and all your near and dear ones, and of course your team at Abacus. We want to hear more. If it's going to be a good year, then in what shape and form, and how do we position for it? How do we gear up for it?
So obviously, Surbhi, you know, from a period of maybe doom and scare, which we were in March and April, the year has ended up pretty optimistically. I think, you know, the Nifty on an overall basis has been up some 14-15% for calendar year 2020. The mid and small cap, after 3 years of underperformance, have finally, you know, risen more than the Nifty, albeit very small, 5-6%. However, you know, as we move forward, there are obviously apprehensions because of the rapid rise in the stock prices. But having said that, you know, from the bottom, yes, stocks have moved up maybe 70, 80, 100% also. But on a 1 year basis, we are still maybe, you know, 15%, which is not a very big rise. And as we move forward, there is a lot of tailwinds also quite visible. You know, so the regular tailwinds of, you know, earnings growth, which is clearly for the first time in maybe 5-6 years, coming in better than what the analyst expected. And I think that is a key driver. And the other biggest tailwind has been all the money printing, which has been done globally, I think that liquidity is going to not only drive flows into the market, but it also aids the businesses because suddenly, you know, you find capital is available in plenty, risk capital is available in plenty, and cost of capital has come down, which sort of ignites demand as well as also leads to a higher profit because interest cost for corporates go down. So I think this is a good sort of a situation to be in. I think the only note of caution would be that, you know, money making has become too easy last 3-4 months. And I think 2021 to that extent might be a little different where you'll have to work to make that returns. It's not that, you know, even if you made mistake, you made 50% return. That was the case last 4-5 months. I think that will change as we move forward. So, you know, thoda kaam karna padega.
थोड़ा काम करना पड़ेगा एक्चुअली. या आई मीन आई वाज नॉट क्रिविंग सुनील, आई वाज जस्ट यू नो स्टेटिंग यू नो व्हाट लुक लॉजिकल. एनीवे नेक्स्ट 2 years यू वोंट हियर मी क्रिविंग बिकॉज नेक्स्ट 2 years इट्स वीकेंड ऑन 1st January. सो
इट्स अ कलेक्टिव क्रिब इफ यू वांट टू कॉल इट दैट सुनील. वी आर कंप्लीटली इन सिंक विद अनुज ऑन दिस वन.
आई जॉइन यू इन दैट क्रिबिंग.
ओके सो नो नाउ सुनील यू नो व्हाट money making is never easy, right? It may sound easy, of course you would know as a fund manager having spent so many years. Now let's talk about some big sectors and some big moves today, Sunil. The news that we have the GST collection at 1.15 lakh crore, the auto sales numbers are looking quite stunning once again, and now you know you can no longer say perhaps that it was just pent up demand, right? Or can you? Your views on the auto sector.
So again, you know, I come back to my earlier point. So obviously, you know, the pent up demand maybe lasted till October, November. I think what happens is, you know, we are human beings. And if we feel good about the future, we end up sort of preponing or even spending money. I think that has been the case. And the other thing is, as I again mentioned earlier, the interest costs have come down. So your EMI's payment for particularly the passenger vehicle side, whether it be 4-wheeler or 2-wheeler, have come down by almost 20-25%, which makes it sort of more affordable for people to, you know, acquire a vehicle. And obviously, this personal mobility because of this scare of pandemic will continue for some time. The heartening part is that the commercial vehicle segment is now starting to come back on track. I think that leads us to believe that finally, even on the economy side, it's not only the consumption-driven economy, but even on the capex side, things have started to move up. And maybe it's a function of commodities doing well, which are big guzzlers of so-called commercial vehicles for movement. Maybe even some of the other sort of sectors like, you know, we have generally the businesses doing well. So logistics and all have started to move up. And the kind of ordering which EPC companies have been sort of announcing, that clearly shows that even the government capex is finally now looking likely. Plus, we are heading into a phase, normally, you know, October, November to May, June is a phase where a lot of infrastructure activities, you know, are at full speed because then you have the monsoon season. So we are also heading into a busy season. So I think all put together, it seems to be a pretty decent and lasting kind of a environment. Obviously, you know, we still have to be cautious about the second wave, second strain. No one knows about it. But I think those concerns are maybe at 5% rather than 50%, which was the case maybe 3-4 months back.
Okay. Sunil, also, you know, a lot of people are looking at playing the recovery through cyclical. So specifically, what part of cyclicals should one concentrate on? Because it's a very wide basket otherwise, if you start looking at, you know, EPC, as you said, some of these other sectors as well.
So Surbhi, again, you know, we are in a period of, you know, ample liquidity, at least for the next 3-4 years. I don't think anyone has a view that the central bank will start to tighten before 2-3 years. And this liquidity is going to last. It is very cheap. You know, interest rates below 1%, almost 65% of the bonds in the world trade at below 1% interest rates. It used to be only 20% when we started 2020. So, you know, you have cheap liquidity. Risk capital is available in plenty. You see the kind of equity deals which are happening. Clearly, you know, there is ample capital. And as we move forward, the last few years, what was happening is that, you know, debt was considered to be taboo. So as a result of which, no company has expanded capacity. Now, as we move forward, you need your steel, you need your cement, you need all your basic industries, you know. And the companies which have capacity are obviously going to mint money because pricing is going to be in their favor. There is demand which is at least for the next 2-3 years going to, you know, be higher than the supply. And therefore, every company which has resources is going to make, you know, I would say more than the normal profit. And in this kind of a scenario, I think integrated metal players, integrated steel players, I would say even integrated chemical players or, you know, to some extent cement, because cement, still there is a lot of ample capacity. I think all of them are going to benefit. Also with dollar weakening, there is a huge investment demand which is flowing into all kinds of commodities. So you see agri commodities, you know, soya, corn, even sugar, all have started to move up. They are up 30-35%. Metals, obviously, you know, you see copper and zinc and nickel and aluminium. It's user demand. On top of it, you have the investment demand through ETFs, which is driving this. So I would say that maybe there was a time where, you know, neat, clean, debt-free company could give you very high returns. But to some extent, the portfolio now has to be geared into companies which can benefit from this huge up move in terms of the cyclical upside.
Okay. Just spoke about all this commodity price surge, Sunil. At some point, do you think there could be a bit of an inflation risk for a market like India and with the, you know, perhaps a bit of a interest rate risk as well, which is important from the mid-cap point of view, right? Mid-caps normally rally in low interest rate environment.
So Anuj, what you're saying is right from a completely book or, you know, the traditional metrics. But, you know, just go back. These are cycles. You will have a cycle where interest rates will fall and then, you know, you'll have all these commodity prices moving up, and then over the next 4-5 years, you'll start to have interest rates inching up because central bank starts to tighten as inflation tightens, and then you'll have the cycle reverse. But these are long cycles. We have just started that cycle. It's not that, you know, you have the prices move up and tomorrow inflation will go up and tomorrow itself the central banks will start to really, really aggressively tighten. You know, you go back to 2003 to 2008 level, you know, period. US Fed increased interest rates by 16 times. You know, interest rates went up to as high as 6.5% before the market started to get worried, and then, you know, you had a sharp fall. So right now, we have not even started the cycle of interest rates tightening. I don't think gradual increase in interest rates to a level of maybe even 3-4% in the US is going to have an impact. But yes, you know, if the tightness is very abrupt, sharp, and very soon, then what you say might be right. But at this point of time, I don't think any central bank can afford to, you know, to end this liquidity, because we are still not out of the COVID-related, you know, unemployment and slowdown in the economy.
Okay. So, Neil, now I know you're not going to talk stocks, but come on, it is the 1st of Jan of brand new year. So give us a hint, you know, some clues on the hot theme or the micro sector to look at.
I think, Surbhi, our funds are, you know, the portfolio is available in public, but, you know, for the benefit of the viewers, you know, I still like the digital theme. I'm a traditional investor and normally I don't like very high PE companies. But this is a theme which is going to last for a long period of time. And, you know, we are all exposed to it on a minute-to-minute basis. You know, the way we work, the way we study, the way we consume, the way we entertain ourselves, the way we shop is all completely changed. So I think anything to do with digital, good promoters, market leadership, you know, potential of growing maybe, you know, 50, 100 times over the next 10, 15 years, I think those companies will be under sort of always the investor radar. Unfortunately, in India, most of these companies are on the unlisted side. But you just check out the companies which are on the listed side. They are just going through the roof because of scarcity, obviously, but also because of the huge moat they have. There is an indirect way of playing it through the IT because it has a similar moat, except that the growth is not going to be as sharp. But we still like the IT space. And, you know, spending on technology is increasing globally. and I think the top line as well as the bottom line performance of these companies will surprise. We like domestic branded companies on the second tier, third tier names. You know, there are a lot of companies which have niche brands in India. And, you know, because the whole market was just focusing on a few large companies over the last 3-4 years, these companies, ended up being available at like 15-18 P with an ROC of 20-25% and good brands. And we are focusing, trying to see if we can buy into a few of them. But that is one good segment. On the metal front, frankly, you can't take a 5-year view. But there are some companies with an integrated model, which I touched upon earlier, which can be looked at from a couple of years point of view. And pharma is going to be a sector which you cannot be ignored. I would, any time, prefer good pharma companies at 20-25 P rather than buy FMCG companies at 50-60 P, because the growth rates of the pharma companies also higher. The potential over the next 3-4 years also looks to be much better. So, you know, I think India is a great investment sort of market in that way. We have so many listed companies across sectors, and there's always something, you know, which you can invest in at all points of time.
Okay, Sunil, I'm asking once again, perhaps, you know, what you'll call a bookish question, but what would be the key risks to monitor in 2021? Because right now, there's a bit of a euphoria. Everything looks good. But the market is also at all-time high and also at all-time high valuation.
So, Anuj, the cliched answer would be the strain of COVID or some new strain coming in. You know, that, frankly, no one knows. But I would say from my side, you know, if money making continues to be as easy as it has been the last 3-4 months, maybe over the next 2-3 months also, I think then it would become really worrying. Right now, despite the last 3-4 months of very good markets, investors generally are underinvested in the equity markets. But if this continues for 2-3 months more, then maybe that changes. And, you know, normally the first quarter is a quarter to watch out for. You know, we have had multiple occasions when, things blow out in January to March quarter. And that's not from a fundamental perspective, but from a technical perspective. So I think what we are watching is whether this easy money making continues for a long period of time. Then things will really be worrying from a market perspective. I think otherwise, we are in a good spot. Finally, I would say that what we needed to do as a country, we are doing. We are focusing on manufacturing. And if we focus on manufacturing, then jobs will automatically be created. Good thing for us is interest rates have come down, because as a country, the bigger issue for us has been high power cost and high interest cost. And both of them are now falling in place, which will make Indian manufacturing also competitive. And with support of the government of India, and also the fact that, which I've mentioned earlier, that China is becoming the villain of the world, I think that can bring in good manufacturing. So we are in a good spot. But, you know, if something becomes too easy, then there is obviously, you have to get your feedback on the ground.
Okay, well, those are wise words and words that our viewers will, of course, benefit from. Thank you very much, Sunil, for joining in today. And once again, greetings for a great 2021 to you. Okay, all right, on that note, we do have to take a quick break. But on the other side, a big global view coming up. What lies ahead for the Indian market in this brand new year? Chris Wood, Global Head of Equity Strategy at Jefferies, joins in for that chat. So stay tuned.